on.
That's great. Is my volume on?
Is that it? Yeah. Is that all you
need? Yeah. Yeah, I think we're set.
Okay. He's almost introduced himself.
Well, I think you just revealed everything they need to know about
you. I like mandolin.
Let me say some good things about you. So, Professor Joe Fornieri, ladies and gentlemen. He's professor of political science at the Rochester Institute of Technology and director of the Center for Statesmanship, Law, and Liberty. He teaches classes on American politics, political philosophy, constitutional rights and liberties, I'm sure a lot of other things, and was awarded the Eisenhart Award for Outstanding Teaching among Senior and Tenured Faculty in 2011. He was a Fulbright lecturer in Prague, where he taught American political thought and First Amendment law, and he served as an advisory member of the Lincoln Bicentennial Commission. You may have heard him mentioning mandolin. Do you actually play mandolin?
Yeah, I just...
Among other things, you play in a band.
Blues band, yeah.
Plays blues music. So, yeah.
You guys ready to jam? Got the harmonicas, I'm loaded.
Good. He's written quite a bit. He's written quite a few books, a lot on Lincoln. And his most recent book, Abraham Lincoln, Philosopher Statesman, published in 2014, won a prize for superior scholarship from the Illinois Historical Society. He's here talk with us a little bit about that and Lincoln and anything else that comes up in the course of our conversation. So, ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Professor Fornieri.
A real heartfelt thanks to everyone here at the Ashbrook Center. And I'd like just to remember just for a moment before I even start, as a fitting tribute, Peter Schramm. I know he touched a lot of lives. He touched my life. He was, as we say in Sicilian, back in Rochester, New York, he was the patron of this place. And I think his spirit is here, and I will do my best to pay tribute to him. It's great to see Sally. I want to thank Dave Tucker. I want to thank Chris. I consider myself a friend, a fan, a faculty member, and perhaps even a family member of the Ashbrook Center here. I've modeled a lot of my own center in Rochester, New York, on the good work you folks have done here. And I'm collaborating with Emily Hess and Professor Burkett on a statesmanship book, American Statesmanship. We see my friend Justin Lyons there, so we have a lot of pals. So I hope I didn't mention anyone. Does anybody know what where this picture's from? Just to kind of start with, yes.
School of Athens.
Yeah, it's the School of Athens, and here you have Raphael portraying Aristotle, who's saying, you know, matter is immanent to form, and Plato. So that was I chose to couple this with my picture of Abraham Lincoln to convey the title of my book, Philosopher Statesman. It sounds like a pretentious title, a philosopher statesman, you know, very abstract. You know, only eggheads could write about philosopher statesman. But I really believe it captures the core of Lincoln's statesmanship. And, you know, throughout the 19th and 20th century, we've wondered what really constitutes Abraham Lincoln's political genius. That's the term that Doris Carnes Goodwin uses in her book Team of Rivals, right? She discusses the political genius of Abraham Lincoln. This is a wonderful work. It is a historical narrative. It tells a story. And Ms. Goodwin really believes that Lincoln's greatness consists in his managerial ability, his ability to manage the strong egos in his cabinet. Now, certainly, that's a part of political greatness, the ability to manage strong egos. Anyone in the academy recognizes that. Yet, it doesn't exhaust it, nor does it provide a standard, okay, some yardstick, some rule and measure for judging political greatness as such. To do that, one has to have a notion of the nature of greatness. What constitutes political greatness as such? What are the core ingredients or the elements of that? And technically, I'm a political philosopher, My approach is a little different than that of a historian. As a political philosopher, I consult the great works of thinkers like Plato, like Aristotle, for their enduring wisdom. And, you know, very much inspired by, Mr. Tucker, very great to see you. I was worried you didn't come. I owe you a great thanks, too.
Plato, Aristotle,
Tucker. See, it was more than a Freudian slip. Okay, thank you so much. I was hoping to see you. So soft-spoken. Thank you. Okay, so consulting the great thinkers like Aristotle and Plato. And my view is that there is enduring wisdom in these works. We can't, you know, translate them in all respects, but there are universal principles, and certainly Abraham Lincoln believed that, and that was part of the core of his statesmanship, the belief in enduring universal principles that served as a rule and measure of human action. So I've mentioned the contribution of political philosophies through my scholarship, and without doubt I was greatly influenced by the great Harry Jaffa, who just passed away. Lincoln embodies in practice, I think, what Aristotle and St. Thomas Aquinas understand in terms of statesmanship. What is this pretentious term, Lincoln's philosophical statesmanship? What do I mean by it? And in the remainder, I have about 25 minutes here, I want to provide an overview. I want to clarify key terms I've drawn from some of the core texts that have been provided to you so that we can have a wider conversation. I'm not going to be, you know, obviously able to discuss everything in depth, but I wanted to provide a framework to stimulate further conversation. So that's my purpose today. Philosophical statesmanship is a political greatness that combines the virtues or the excellences of thought and action. It combines theory and practice. What the Greeks and what the Christians referred to as theoretical and practical wisdom, those great virtues. It combines an intellectual and a moral excellence. We're all aware that the intellect can be used for wicked purposes, for wicked ends. The intellect may sell its wares to the good and evil. So character is absolutely crucial here. I'm something of an Augustinian in believing that the will really orients the direction of the intellect. And I think that's the case with Lincoln and with this philosophical statesmanship in terms of both greatness of thought and greatness of character. It unites theoretical and practical wisdom with, here's another interesting term, a magnanimous and sacrificial service for the common good. Okay, that's my core definition here, and I'll in a moment discuss what I mean by magnanimity. Really, the term literally means greatness of soul, but it has to do with observing the mean in regard to great honors and recognition. Okay, it is not unprecedented. Philosophical statesmanship is not unprecedented. We can think of Cicero and Marcus Aurelius, perhaps, Thomas More. These were both philosophical and practical statesmen. John Adams, I would say, our founders. Jefferson, Adams point to the possibility, Hamilton point to the possibility of philosophical statesmanship. And Lincoln's own words bear witness to this philosophical statesmanship. This is a fascinating quote in his, around the time of the debate with Stephen Douglas. And notice how Lincoln connects philosophy and statesmanship in the same sentence here. He was inveighing against his opponent, Stephen Douglas's moral relativism, right? The doctrine that nothing is inherently good or evil, but relative to the tastes or the preferences of territorial settlers in regard to the slavery question. So Lincoln, in response to that moral relativism, said, where is the philosophy or statesmanship which assumes that you can quiet that disturbing element in our society, slavery, which has disturbed us for more than half a country, based on the assumption that we are to quit talking about it? I mean, I think we hear the same advice in regard to some of the troublesome moral in political issues vexing us today. Let's not talk about it. It's only going to invite profound disagreement, and such moral issues are divisive, so we won't discuss them. Or they can't be resolved in any rational manner. Okay. Lincoln opposes this. His philosophical statesmanship can be seen as rejecting this moral relativism. Lincoln also spoke of a philosophical public opinion. He spoke of the public mind. And here, rhetoric is a key component, persuasion, of his philosophical statesmanship in molding public opinion and disposing public opinion to support the Union cause in the inseparability of liberty and union. For Lincoln, preserving the Union meant preserving the principles for which it stood, namely a Union dedicated to the principles of the Declaration of Independence. And his task as a statesman, in part, was to form the climate of public opinion. And that meant rebutting alternative views of civil life and of democracy and of Republican government. Today we take for granted that slavery and democracy are incompatible, that they are antithetical to one another. That was not the case in the 19th century, right? I mean, as we'll see, the Civil War was a battle of ideas as well. And Lincoln's philosophical statesmanship comes to light as an ability to provide an ultimate moral justification for the Union cause and to shape public opinion in accordance with this noble vision of public life. But it was a noble vision that contrasted, that rebutted the pro-slavery visions of the likes of someone like John C. Calhoun, Slavery is a Positive Good, which is in your readings. I think, again, I don't want to be too over the top, but I think that the primary documents and the website that you folks have put together here is amongst the best. You can find almost everything I'm referring to in those documents of American history. John C. Calhoun, Fitzhugh's, Cannibals All, Hammond's, you're familiar with John Hammond's Mudsill Theory. Okay, these were arguments, pro-slavery arguments, that saw a union as perfectly compatible with the sovereignty of states and with the institution of slavery. And Lincoln intellectually engaged these ideas, he rebutted them, and he was able to shape public opinion in doing so. That therein consists part of his greatness. We can see Lincoln's philosophical mind and the philosophical mind of anyone in the ability to go to trace political questions back to first principles, right? First causes or first principles. This is someone who thinks philosophically. Not simply at a superficial level, but who wants to get to the core causes of something. And here Lincoln, at a Republican banquet, where he's writing a letter to he wasn't able to attend, but to friends who invited him to a Republican Party banquet. And he says this, "The principles of Jefferson," keep in mind that Jefferson was the father of the Democratic Party, and Lincoln and the Republicans are claiming the moral high ground, with Jefferson being as the true heirs of Thomas Jefferson. "The principles of Jefferson are the definitions and axioms of free society." Lincoln had read Euclid and saw equality as a first principle, an axiom of free society. And yet they are denied and evaded with no small show of success. One dashingly calls them glittering generalities. This was John C. Calhoun. And again, Lincoln's political, philosophical statesmanship emerging in contrast to, and as a rebuttal to John C. Calhoun's views. Another bluntly calls them self-evident lies. This is Senator Pettit of Indiana, who Lincoln said should have been taken outside and pommeled. And still, he really didn't get, he got worked up sometimes, Lincoln, about these things. And still others insidiously argue that they apply only to superior races. Okay. My book provides, as I said, a framework. And I'm not saying that this framework is exhausted, but I would say that these are, in fact, some of the core ingredients of statesmanship, and we could use this framework to judge other leaders to the extent that they fall short, to the extent that they act in accordance with these core six dimensions of Lincoln's philosophical statesmanship. Let me just enumerate them, and in the remaining time, I'll spend a little bit of a moment on a few of them here. One I mentioned is theoretical wisdom, and by this I mean one's noble vision of public life, the noble vision of human nature. Any political philosophy is constructed, is grounded upon some normative vision of how things ought to be of human nature, right? What human nature and society is. Are human beings simply material beings? Are we, is our consciousness radically shaped by the vicissitudes of history? Are there enduring truths? Are we profoundly egocentric and incapable of acting in accordance with any higher principles of the common good so understood? So this noble vision is informed by some understanding of human nature. Prudence or practical wisdom. It's one thing to have a noble vision. It's another thing to be able to apply that noble vision to politics here. And we know that we've seen in history, history keeps us honest, that very often one's political dream, if applied imprudently, turns out to be a nightmare. Is the hell, is the saying goes, the road to hell is paved with good intentions. So prudence is the ability to apply moral principles under the circumstances. And here you have the combination of theory and practice and with Lincoln's statesmanship. Duty. Duty isn't so much a virtue. You are virtuous, your duty. What I mean here is that duty should be taken into consideration when we judge statesmen. The parameters of statesmanship are circumscribed by duty, and that means one's oath of office. That means the charge of the public office. Okay, we could criticize Lincoln from the standpoint of the radical abolitionist that he didn't act quickly enough, or he was too compromising in regard to slavery, but that completely neglects his official duty in upholding the Constitution, and that meant some of the concessions to slavery. Duty both constrained and empowered the president. Magnanimity, or greatness of soul. We'll mention this in a moment here. By magnanimity, I mean the observing the proper mean in terms of honors. And we also mean the capacity, the ability to do great things on a large level, as Aristotle, at a wide level, Aristotle says in the Rhetoric. Magnanimity. It's the crown. It is the crown of all the other virtues. Here, by magnanimity, I really follow Thomas Aquinas' understanding that this is a magnanimity that involves, this greatness of soul involves humility and sacrificial service as well. Okay? Humility is a crucial component to this greatness. And Christian norms for Aquinas influence his understanding of magnanimity, and here he takes Aristotle to task a little bit. He borrows from Aristotle, but without question modifies Aristotle in some regard. Rhetoric, the ability to persuade, which we've mentioned. And patriotism, much is said about Lincoln's ambition, and his law partner, William Herndon, referred to it as a little engine that knows no rest. And certainly Lincoln was ambitious, but there were boundaries to this. There are moral boundaries to this ambition. And there is such a thing as an honorable ambition that serves the common good and is willing to sacrifice it. Lincoln was more than a disembodied intellect calculating the costs and benefits of his political decision-making and how they would affect his reputation. That patriotism was a matter of the heart as well as the head. It was an effective dimension. Somehow we're afraid to use the term or even consider patriotism because it gets identified with jingoism. And here I show that Lincoln's love of country was ordinate, that it was bound by moral standards, that it involved both an intellectual dimension, fidelity to the principles of the Declaration, but it also had an effective dimension as well, a passion for the Union and for the promise of the Union and for those who advance the noble cause of the Union through their sacrifice. Okay. All right. In the remaining time, let's just consider in a little more detail some of these dimensions of Lincoln's philosophical statesmanship. I've already provided something of a tour. Theoretical wisdom here is the first dimension. And by that I mean the noble vision of the common good of man and society. The Book of Proverbs gets it, says it well, that where there is no vision, the people perish. So the biblical wisdom gets that pretty concisely and tersely there. This vision, and of course one's vision could be noble or one's vision can be distorted in some manner, right? I mean, the vision of a racially supreme society, okay, a racial supremacist society, or a completely materialist vision of human nature, where we're nothing more than matter in motion, are, I think, all distort the human condition. And if they serve as guides in politics, they can really lead us astray. Okay, so Lincoln, as we saw, spoke in terms of a philosophical statesmanship that was bound by the moral principles of the Declaration of Independence, and recognized that the you could not evade fundamental moral questions. Okay. But here he's talking to Alexander Stevens, who was a member of the Whig Party before the Civil War. He's hoping that Alexander Stevens will side with the Union. Stevens actually opposed Georgia's secession ordinance. He was one of the few, yet ultimately became vice president of the Confederacy. So Lincoln was attempting to reach out to Stevens right before the first shots were fired, hoping that he could remain within the Union. And he's talking about what the Union means. And of course he goes, "This has a philosophical cause," says Lincoln. "The principle of equality was the word fitly spoken, which has proved an apple of gold to us. The Union and the Constitution are the picture of silver subsequently framed around it." This aphorism here, based on Proverbs 23, okay, a word fitly spoken is like an apple of gold in a picture of silver, okay, really gets to the core of Lincoln's philosophical statesmanship. The two core moral covenants, the two documents that inform, the two sources that provide normative guidance. One is the Declaration of Independence and its teaching of natural rights under natural law. And two is the Constitution. So Lincoln uses this analogy that the picture was made not to conceal or destroy the apple, but to adorn and preserve it. The picture was made for the apple, not the apple for the picture. That somehow the principles of the Declaration are morally prior. That as Harry Jaffa would argue, that the Constitution should be read in view of the first principles of the Declaration as much as possible. These are the guiding core principles, and there you go. The philosophical cause was the inseparability of union and liberty. I've mentioned that Lincoln's philosophical doctrine was that of natural rights under natural law. Here we could have an entire course taught on this and the difference between modern, medieval, and natural right and natural law. Suffice it to say, I want to provide some clarity in regard to this issue. Lincoln saw the Declaration as the moral foundation and covenant, moral covenant of the regime. It was the ancient faith of the regime. And it provided a teaching of legitimate government that ruled and measured human actions. And here, this understanding of natural rights and natural rights under natural law is consistent with the wider tradition, going back to Aristotle, going back to Cicero, a certain understanding of Locke as not simply a materialist atheist, Sidney Jefferson and Lincoln. One can follow the trajectory of this tradition. There are obviously differences between these, but there's also a consensus. What is this consensus? How do I define the doctrine of natural rights under natural law? Very briefly, in a 5-minute nutshell here. One, that there are universal moral principles that are rationally discernible. Not willed, but discovered and rationally discernible. Two, that these principles are ultimately derived from the laws of nature and nature's God. They are part of a pre-existing order. They are not created. That they serve as a rule and measure and guide for human action. And that these rights are not mere entitlements. They may be entitlements, but they are consistent with the moral law. As Lincoln says, and as Harry Jaffa reminded us so much, you don't have the right to do wrong. Okay? That is the doctrine of natural rights under natural law. We see this doctrine expressed very powerfully in the Peoria speech of October 16, 1854. Again, it's one of the crucial documents here at the Ashbrook Center in your online sources. Here we see the relationship between the principle of equality, consent, and self-government. They are correlative. One implies the other. Okay? Lincoln draws the logical conclusions from this philosophically. If the Negro is a man, is it not to that extent a total destruction of self-government to say that he too shall not govern himself? When the white man governs himself, that is self-government. But when he governs himself and also governs another man, that is more than self-government, that is despotism. Why? Because if the Negro is a man, his ancient faith in the Declaration teaches me that all men are created equal and that there can be no, notice, moral rights in connection with one man's making a slave of another. That consent is a requirement of the core principle of equality. And equality is the cornerstone of self-government, okay, as well. Lincoln says, what I do say is that no man is good enough to govern another man without that other's consent. This is the leading principle. This is the sheet anchor of American republicanism. And you could see here that the depravity of human nature is just as relevant to democracy as the dignity of human nature. Okay? Our dignity consists in our rational and our moral abilities. For Christians, for believers, it consists that we are created imago Dei in the image of God. Okay? But just as relevant to equality, that we are fundamentally equal, that no one is so superior as to be above the moral law, no one is so inferior as to be treated like a subhuman or brute, is the fact that no one is good enough to govern another person without that other person's consent. Not even Mother Teresa. Okay? Bad joke. not even Mother Teresa, right? Why? Because no one can be entrusted with absolute power. That is part of Lincoln's understanding of equality in human nature, this vision of human nature. No one is an angel. No one is a complete demon. And power must be checked. Okay? Now, here's a competing vision, as I mentioned at the beginning of class, of the Union and of American self-government that we need to take seriously. This is what Alexander said famously at his inauguration as Vice President of the Confederacy. It's interesting because Stevens was influenced by the new scientific racial views of Count Gobineau. Is anyone familiar with this? It's a fascinating work. Stevens actually had it translated from French into English, and it said that, you know, the downfall of all humanity consisted in racial mixing and the mongrelization of races. And of course, there was a whole hierarchy of races who were most pure Nordic and Anglo, and then as you go down the scale, African Americans are on the bottom, and just a little bit above them are Southern Italians. So that was interesting to find out the genetic character. I'm going to do the 23 or the 46. Okay, so that was his view. Count Gobineau. It's very interesting to take a look at it. Our new Confederacy is founded upon exactly the opposite idea of equality. Its foundations are laid. Its cornerstone rests. Again, this is a reference to the Bible, right? The cornerstone. Christ is the cornerstone of the new faith. Its foundations are laid, its cornerstone rests upon the great truth that the Negro is not equal to the white man, that slavery, subordination to the superior race, is his natural and normal condition. This, our new government, is the first in the history of the world based upon this great physical and moral truth. And again, by physical, he means scientific. It's not the first time that pseudoscience has led us astray in terms of dehumanizing fellow human beings and stripping them of their dignity in the name of science. Again, the Civil War can be seen as a battle of ideas, and Lincoln engaged those ideas philosophically via his theoretical wisdom and politically on the battlefield as commander-in-chief, bound to the Constitution, seeking to advance the cause of liberty and union. I mentioned practical wisdom as another element here. What I do want to talk about here, I want to conclude. I have to conclude with something about Rochester, the Rock, that's what we call it. Frederick Douglass from Rochester, I think he captures Lincoln's statesmanship best. Certainly not without criticism of Abraham Lincoln. Early on, Douglass came to greatly admire and respect Lincoln towards the end of his life. And I think this just says it perfectly. So, with some local pride, I end on saying, Lincoln was a great man, a great mean. Sorry. I'm going to be punished for that when I go to Mount Hope Cemetery and see him. Tender of heart, strong of nerve, of boundless patience and broadest sympathies, with no motive apart from his country. Again, the importance of patriotism is an effective dimension, the passion that's necessary for statesmanship. He could receive counsel from a child and give counsel to a sage. The simple approached him with ease and learned approached him with deference. Take him for all in all, Abraham Lincoln was one of the noblest, wisest, and best men I ever knew. So with that in mind, you guys can consider the lineup and we can judge accordingly which candidate, and I'm going to let you do this, which candidate best qualifies as a philosophical statesperson. So thank you so much, Ashbrook Center. I hope that was helpful. I'm here to raise some questions, and I welcome your questions. Thank you.
Knowledgeable scholars on Lincoln in the country here, so I'm sure there are some great questions that they have for you, gentlemen. So please.
Thank you so much. Sir.
Well, first and foremost, thank you for coming. You say the Civil War is a battle of ideas, and I don't disagree with that. My question, though, is how do you account for the victory of the Union and the ideas of the Union without resorting to some form of historicism that Hegelians would promote?
Oh, I see. Was it the historicism of Hegelianism, or was it the commitment to the principles, to the natural right, natural law teaching?
I guess a better question would be how.
Because I see it as really just the opposite, that it vindicates this, that there are timeless truths, right? That it was our commitment to the principles of liberty and union that ultimately prevailed in the inner logic of those principles, right? In extending them to all human beings. But no, go ahead, please.
I guess the better question was, in what manner does true principles motivate a man against false ones?
Certainly that's, I think that's part of the struggle, right, of human life and of education, that when I talk about rhetoric, Lincoln is a dimension of Lincoln's philosophical statesmanship. This is a war for public opinion and ideas, like you're saying. Lincoln referred to his opponents as sophists. He used the term sophistry quite often, which is interesting. What is sophistry? Well, sophistry presumes that something is true and something is a distortion of the truth and something is a manipulation. We may not accept that today with our moral relativism, but Lincoln certainly accepted it, and he stigmatized secessionist doctrines as Selfridge, saying the problem was, and you have a very good question, I mean, the problem was so many in the South had been reared on those opinions of racial supremacy, of secession in defense of states' rights, and held them, you know, as their core principles. When, you know, God forbid, when you have a breakdown of core principles to such an extent, there can be no compromise aside from the, profound conflict. It's interesting, today, we hear that, you know, the term sophistry was used by Lincoln. Today, we're hearing a lot about the term demagoguery, okay? I take it another useful term, right, to contrast to, let's say, Lincoln's philosophical rhetoric, his ability to elevate and ennoble the public and guide public opinion in accordance with some noble vision. How do we see demagoguery? Demagoguery is pandering, right? Playing upon the worst base fears of the audience and this ability to manipulate the audience by demonstrating one's solidarity with them. You know, the classic example is, you know, Mark Antony. You know, I come to bury Caesar, and we see how he's so effective at making himself one of the people and then arousing the people to turn against Brutus and Cassius. We see demagoguery and that type of pandering on almost every issue. Race, economics, class warfare. The demagogue is adept at dividing. I'm a uniter, not a divider. Sorry. Yes, please. What was your name?
Cameron. Thank you for coming.
Thank you.
Lincoln once said that if he could save the Union without freeing a single slave, he would do it. If he could save the Union while freeing some, leaving others in bondage, he would do it. How did Lincoln's statesmanship help him with that decision on how to save the Union and how to advance the principles of freedom and abolition?
That's a great question, I like it that you make reference to specific texts. Peter would be proud. I remember him saying, always reference the text. So you're referring to very famous slash infamous for some letter that Lincoln wrote to Horace Greeley in August of 1862, prior to the preliminary emancipation. And Lincoln said, "My paramount object in this struggle is to preserve the Union. What I do with the slaves will be subordinate to that. If I could free all the slaves in preserving the Union, I would do it. If I could free none of the slaves and preserve the Union, I would do it. If I could free some of the slaves and leave others alone, I would do it." Now, how does it fit with Lincoln's statesmanship? To me, this is quintessential prudence or practical wisdom. Lincoln is bound by the Constitution, which had established a firewall between the slave states and the national government, okay? You had the anomalous situation during the Civil War era of the border states that still had slaves who remained within the Union. Kentucky, okay, Missouri, Maryland, Delaware. Lincoln says to lose Kentucky is to lose the whole game. They were crucial to the strategic success of the Union cause. So you don't want to alienate those border states practically, and you don't have the constitutional authority to free slaves in the state without an amendment. Now, the Emancipation Proclamation was justified, as we know, as a war measure, and therefore it applied only to belligerents. And that provided Lincoln on a much stronger constitutional ground, okay, for affecting this vision. Now, there's a couple other things worth mentioning here. When Lincoln said, "My paramount object is to preserve the Union," okay, we know that Lincoln wrote very carefully and parsed his words. Paramount means first and foremost. It doesn't mean only. So for Lincoln, really, if we look at Republican doctrine from Peoria speech in 1854 onward, preserving the Union for Lincoln always meant preserving the principles for which the Union stood. It is an anti-slavery union. It is not the union of George McClellan, where blacks will be returned to slavery and all the strides made towards black freedom will be nullified once the next administration takes in. No. It is a union dedicated to the ultimate extinction of slavery through lawful means, of which the Emancipation Proclamation was one. Finally, Lincoln did not, what's often not mentioned is that Lincoln had proposed a federal buyout, a lawful federal buyout of the slaves from the border states. That's often not mentioned. I remember I taught at the high school level. I used to get so mad because they had a New York State Regents question. And Lincoln's goal during the Civil War was A, to preserve the Union, B, to end slavery. And you were supposed to choose A. I got irritated with that question. It was like the only question on the Civil War. Besides, here I'm ranting, sorry. After praising New York, now I'm ripping it apart. It's the schizophrenia of New York. So,
hey, Donald.
it gives the impression that these two goals were incompatible, when in fact, they were compatible. And Lincoln had actually written a preliminary draft of the Emancipation Proclamation a month before this letter to Greeley. So he knew perfectly well that option C, freeing some and leaving others alone, was going to be the option that was chosen. Great question. Thank you. I hope I wasn't too long-winded.
Don't, I'm sorry. Can I just ask a follow-up?
Yeah, please.
I don't normally do this, but this is such a good question.
Please. So this tea is great.
The others that you
support. Sorry.
If you answer my question.
I don't think we have sweet tea.
No.
We don't. Okay, go ahead.
The letter to Horace Greeley, as you were just mentioning,
yeah.
I think, because, as you were just suggesting, it actually makes known publicly that there is the possibility that he would free some slaves to save the Union. That's the first time, to my knowledge, that he makes such a possibility.
That's absolutely right, Professor Burkett. And you're right. I think you're right to point that out. That's a big apple that I forgot there. If you read this, okay, this was Lincoln shaping public opinion because that was the way he got his message across. Right, there was no TV. So these messages or these letters would be published in newspapers with the understanding that the whole country was reading them, right? In fact, he really spanked Greeley because Greeley criticized him in his newspaper, the New York Tribune, and Lincoln gave the response in the competing newspaper in New York, right? It was published. So, this was the first time a president even admitted that he had the authority to do this, because this was verboten, right? I mean, this was, no president had ever considered this or stated publicly that he had the authority to do so. So, thank you so much.
You want some sugar?
Is it? That's good tea. Go you, please, yes. Please state your name so I can.
Hayden.
Yeah.
Thank you for coming.
Thank you, guys.
One of the things you talked about, you touched on patriotism.
Yes.
And obviously today we see patriotism is kind of a dangerous thing. I don't think there's a candidate out there who doesn't claim to be the most patriotic or more so than the other guy.
Yeah.
And the Civil War, I assume it was no different. You know, I don't think anyone for the Southern states would say that they weren't being patriotic in the cause. So where is the discrepancy there? What is good patriotism? Why is Lincoln's patriotism different?
It's a great question. Great question. You're right to point out, and I have to be careful here. Could we really look? Tell those Southern boys that fought that you weren't patriotic, right? But I will say, in that regard, their devotion was to what? Their allegiance was to the state, and it was to the institution of slavery that made their states, that made that Confederacy unique. And I would say that was wrong, right? We could say, given the nature of, here it comes back to, how do we understand the Union, right? That even James Madison, right, who wrote the the Virginia Resolution, which was a toned-down version of Jefferson's Kentucky Resolution, which suggested that states could interpose, okay, if the national government overstepped its boundaries. Even Madison says, you know, secession nullification is objectionable. It's unconscionable. And that he, his thought provided towards the end of his life no basis for this. So we have, you know, I think we could make those distinctions if we look at the founders, if we look at the understanding of the Union, right? Was this understanding of the Union one that allowed states to unilaterally withdraw? People praised Robert E. Lee, right? In you know, the very romantic moment where you know, he's, you know, I cannot raise my hand against my beloved Virginia. Oh, sorry, Robert, you're wrong. You swore an oath. You swore an oath, and a lot of boys might have been saved. In fact, if you were on the right side. So again, I think that there are sophistic doctrines that one could serve. Right here, I would say that those doctrines were, I characterize them as kind of is a chauvinism, and I distinguish patriotism from chauvinism. For Lincoln, the patriotic affection, and you're right, there are dangers to this, right? But the patriotic affection is tempered by devotion to rational moral principles too. So it's balanced. So it's not a disembodied intellectual cogitation on first principles. There is an affected element, but it's also ruled and measured by these first principles. And the golden rule, do unto others. We have to revive some a benign patriotism that we can somehow distinguish, and I hope I've tried to do it. You're right for pointing this, you know, taking me to task on this. That's different from jingoism, right? Lincoln opposed manifest destiny. That was a kind of patriotism, right? We could say he thought that the Mexican War was a land grab to perpetuate slavery. He also opposed nativism, right? Oh, those hordes of Irish and German are coming over. You know, he could have jumped on the bandwagon, and like some of the Whigs did. So the Whigs were Lincoln's former party were more associated with that nativist sentiment. But Lincoln's patriotism didn't fall into that trap. I say he correctly understood that the American creed means that we don't distinguish on the basis of race, creed, or color. We don't target groups of people. When we talk about that, we have to be very cautious, whether they're Muslim, whether they're Mexican, okay? We be very careful. I hope that's helpful. Yes, did you have it? No, you didn't, please, yes.
Thank you for coming, my name's Logan.
Logan?
My question is related to when Lincoln suspended habeas corpus. And do you find it just
guys
that
are making
he
me sweat
suspended
up here.
Habeas corpus?
Go ahead.
And do you find it just that he suspended habeas corpus and his ignoring Justice Taney when they decided on ex parte Merriman?
Very good. Very good. Again, excellent. I would defend, I do, in the book, and I do, and I would defend Lincoln in suspending the writ of habeas corpus. I think Taney overstepped his bounds. He overstepped his bounds in Dred Scott. He overstepped his bounds in Merriman. Let me just, for those that don't know, the writ of habeas corpus is a due process safeguard, going back to our British cousins, okay, during medieval times. And what it does is it protects against arbitrary arrest. If the writ of habeas corpus is suspended, okay, it means that you can be detained and held indefinitely without a trial. Now, what's interesting is the Constitution in Article 1 says the provision of the writ of habeas corpus shall not be suspended except and in cases of rebellion or invasion when the public safety requires it. Lincoln makes much of this. Now, of course, Article 1 is dedicated to congressional power, but not exclusively, right? There's other elements of Article 1 that deal with the other branches. Lincoln says that the fact that there are exceptions to the suspension of the writ of habeas corpus shows that the intention of the Constitution, that the founders' intent was to distinguish between the Constitution in peacetime and wartime, and to provide for such an exigency that occurred. Now, also, Congress was out of session when Lincoln suspended the writ of habeas corpus, okay? And some of the elections had still not been decided yet, right? There was no uniform election date, the first Tuesday after the first Monday in November. I still don't know how they came up with that. I think it had to do with crop rotations, you know, back in, I'm not kidding, right? So that's our election day. But that wasn't uniform at the time, and states still had elections. By the time Lincoln is inaugurated in March, and of course, the nation's capital was encircled, and soldiers were prevented. They were mobbed on several occasions, and bridges were destroyed to prevent Union troops from fortifying Washington, D.C. The Confederates could have launched a preemptive strike and taken D.C. and really demoralized the Union cause early in the war. If there was someone, you know, you said Jeb Stuart across the Potomac at that time, that would have been the time to strike a knockout blow, because it was pretty vulnerable. So that, I think, provides greater justification in my view. Go ahead, please.
Just to follow up, why? I mean, he could have just taken, yeah, this is unconstitutional, but why does he always go through the route that he always has to justify himself that it is always constitutional?
Statesmanship. He wants to show that he's taking his constitutional oath seriously, and that he is not the radical agitator, you know, that the South has painted him as, right? The South has painted Lincoln and the Republican Party as, you know, the radical party of John Brown. And that they're going to, once they get in office, they're going to completely violate our constitutional rights. So practically, he has to walk the walk if he wants to maintain a war coalition of moderates who are very suspicious about this Republican administration. So, you know, there's both, in politics, as with anything, there's principal motives, but there's also self-preservational motives, right, for the survival of the Republican Party at the next election. They trample on the Constitution, they're not going to be reelected. They're going to be replaced by the Democrats. And in fact, at least in the interim elections, after the Emancipation Proclamation, Republicans took a beating in the House. So. Yes, young lady.
Hi, thank you.
Kayla.
So, as we discussed today, like, Lincoln was highly regarded for his intellect, his virtue, and his strong leadership skills. And then,
now, not back then. They thought, you know, the
now,
original gorilla, yeah.
And then you put up a slide like that behind you, and we all laugh. Why is it that we're not able to...
Should I not have done that? I couldn't help myself. I'm sorry.
But why is it now that we're not able to get a candidate that we're able to view in the same light when running for president?
That's a great question. I don't know if I can answer it. I remember at Mass one day. I'm Catholic, and the priest was going on about how you get the priest who you deserve. If you get a priest who's so easy with you and lets you off the hook on everything, you're gonna get the priest. And I'm not making funny. I'm actually doing it quite affectionately, because there was a message there, right? We get the leaders that we deserve. That these leaders are a reflection, I think, of us and of our culture. Whether now again, I don't want to make students cynical, right? We have to choose. I think your point is well taken in the fact that. The fact that you could raise that question shows that you have some reflective intellectual distance. I think it's more worrisome and troublesome when people, you know, are true believers and will believe anything, right? The person that believes anything will, you know, believes really ultimately in nothing, right? Because you just completely excuse the actions of these leaders and don't hold them accountable. So I the survival of our republic depends upon it. It's up to you guys. You know, it's something of a cliche, but it is. You know, we have a $19 trillion debt. We'll see if you guys get any Social Security by the time you retire. I'm worried. Dave, I'm not going to say my age, but I'm a little nervous about this, right? You know, it's up to you. It's up to you folks. But I think trends make it, very difficult. Sound bites, Twitter, tweets, the low level of political discourse. This has been going on for some time, and I think it's interesting that if we look at this election, we have two outsiders, maybe even three. One could make the argument that Cruz is an outsider. Is that okay? That because he's part of the Tea Party, and he's a maverick, and the establishment doesn't like him. Okay, so there's yours. No, I put him in the middle. So you could make the argument about Cruz. So why are we turning to outsiders? What does that say? I think the country as a whole feels that neither party's providing a viable alternative. And there's been such dysfunction and gridlock. Congress, whether you're a Democrat or Republican, has, in my opinion, abdicated its responsibility. In my few forays into, because I try to remain impartial, my few forays into practical politics in writing editorials has been kind of my anger at Congress for just being prostrate. I mean, it's the most representative branch. Everything from immigration policy. So are we going to look to a president to just act when Congress doesn't? Now we don't have a republic anymore. So I can't completely, I hope I tried to answer. I want to get depressed. Yes, you had a question. Oh, you guys don't have to thank me anymore, please. It's so nice. Thank you.
My name's Allie. You mentioned one of the criteria that made Lincoln a statesman was his duty and understanding his duty as president.
Let's put it this way. That's true. When we look at statesmanship, we have to keep in mind what is the duty and how do they perform, how well do they perform their duty? Like think of Nixon, right? Or Buchanan, the president before Lincoln, you know? Secession is wrong, but I can't do anything about it. Go ahead. Declaration of impotence, right? So, go ahead.
What I was
going
to ask was, would you
limit
statesmen then to only political office holders?
That's a great question. Do I? Oh, you're gonna nail me on that too. That's a great question. I what was your name?
Hallie.
Sorry, I wrestled with that, because it does. It narrows the scope of what we would consider statesmanship, and it would mean technically someone like Frederick Douglass is not a statesman in the same way that Lincoln is. No, but and it would mean. Here's the thing, though. It would mean that Martin Luther King, who I admire, is not a statesman. But I think I could argue that because I want to. What I'm seeing so much is that the lines of leadership are completely blurred. Another reason I love the Ashbrook Center. You folks have your vision focused on statesmanship. A lot of other schools, okay, it's leadership. What's leadership? Leadership is salesmanship. I can sell you a new car, right? So let's go to college to learn how to, to sell people used cars and rip them off. That's, every place we're going to make you a leader, right? We teach leadership. Everybody claims to teach leadership. But then we don't, again, respect and understand, I think, is distinctly the unique character of political leadership, which involves duty. Now, statesmanship, state statesmanship, yes. So, what do you do? How do you refer to Martin Luther King? And think about, but King, King really was not an elected, he was not an elected public official. He agitated from outside. He was a reformer. and then has virtues of its own, right? The reformer, I think, could use much more uncompromising rhetoric in terms to affect public opinion. And the reformer stance is very often more narrow, right? Not the whole kit and caboodle of public policies, but the focus on, let's say, dramatizing one injustice. Those are important distinctions to make, and it explains, I think, some of the policies. Could King have been successful without, I can't believe I'm saying this, but Lyndon Johnson? Right? We got to give Lyndy his due. I don't want to beat him up on him too much, but right? I mean, Lyndon Johnson and the Congress that was able to affect civil rights. Right? Does that mean Johnson's a statesman? You make the call. Thank you. It's a great question. Let's all think about what would we call someone like an Elizabeth Cady Stanton, a Frederick Douglass. I'm going to have you revise that. You know, she's from Rochester, too, so be careful.
Can I follow up on...
Uh-oh. Go ahead, yeah.
Well, I'm wondering, when you use the word duty, don't we all, whether it be as citizens or as president or as a congressman, have a particular duty within the republic? And so, in a way, by using the term duty, it actually expands the definition of statesmanship. And if your book is emphasizing philosophical statesmanship and emphasizes principle, doesn't that broaden, aren't you broadening the definition that might allow a certain key figure, a few key figures in the 19th century?
So I think patriotism,
King is also a problematic parallel with Douglas, because unlike Douglas, King actually changes his opinion and changes his principle in the way that he views.
You know, it's sad to say, I love Frederick Douglass and his writings.
I'll be your teacher.
It's no secret, okay? But he did appeal, his appeal was very narrow. Even the circulation of his newspapers was significantly smaller. So.
But he was an advisor to Lincoln.
He was or wasn't?
He was.
They met on three occasions.
Lincoln's observations are that Douglas significantly swayed him.
I think there was an influence there, yeah.
Well, I'm just saying that black newspaper circulation doesn't necessarily...
Sorry. No, it's a good question.
Thank you for coming, too.
I'm Dennis. Thank you for coming. Lincoln is often criticized by some for being, they say that while did for the slaves, he was in some way racist, because he said things, in one speech, he said something to the effect of, just because I don't want a black woman to be a slave doesn't mean I'll marry her.
Right.
They said things like that point to a view of a racial inequality is argued.
Yeah.
How did Lincoln's view of equality and equality of any sort of natural equality of all people, how does that sort of jive with what he said in the speech that I don't remember offhand exactly what speech it is, or things like that he said?
I think you're referring to one of the most controversial remarks he made was at Charleston, not South Carolina, but Illinois, during the Lincoln-Douglas debates, when he says, if I'm to the extent, something I'm paraphrasing, that if one must have a superior race, there must be a superior race, as much as anyone else, and for having the white race be considered, be the superior race. But when you look at that, again, his language is highly qualified and tortured, and the premise is that one has to choose, right? But as we look at Lincoln, you read the speech further on, he says, let's do away with this superior and inferior and go back to the old principle, all men are created equal. I see these remarks as rhetorical accommodations to the racial prejudices of his audience. The state of Illinois had a black exclusion law that was passed less than 10 years before the Lincoln-Douglas debate by overwhelming, I think, 70% margins. The black exclusion law forbid free slaves, free blacks, from entering into to Illinois. And in the state of Illinois, Michael Burlingame, in his huge biography, refers it to it as the most racist free state in the Union. Blacks could not serve as jurors. All these things that Lincoln, I'm not in favor of intermarrying, I'm not in favor of making blacks jurors, all these things were banned under the black exclusion law. So Lincoln was being really pommeled on the racial question by his opponent, Stephen Douglas. And he had to, I think, this is my interpretation, he had to walk a real fine line between being anti-slavery, but not allowing his opponent to cast him as a radical abolitionist, because that would have been political suicide in the state of Illinois. So he had to make these concessions. Now, who do I turn to kind of get a window in on, you know, how Lincoln really felt about race? I think Douglas. I mean, there's some remarkable things Douglas said about several of their meetings. And, he said famously, he was the only white man who never reminded me of my race. And of course, what happens when Douglas meets Lincoln's successor, Johnson? It's a complete disaster, right? It's a complete disaster. I mean, he almost comes to fisticuffs. Douglas is insulted, and he should be. Johnson uses racist, demeaning language, is completely condescending. Quite different from Lincoln, who sees Douglas during the second inaugural, where he's being escorted out because he's black, and Lincoln goes, "Oh, there's my friend Douglas. Come up here," right? There's something to that. I don't think Lincoln did not have a lot of experience with black people in Illinois or in Indiana where he lived. Okay, but. And I think he used, you know, some of those stereotypes, and I'm sure some of the language, the salty language was used. But I think that actually he was pretty far advanced in terms of his that's my view, his racial views. Yes?
Hi, my name's Zach. This is a follow-up on Kayla's question several questions ago. You mentioned that, we get the leader that we deserve. What made the people?
I don't want to sound like that priest, you know. Fornieri's a masochist, right? You know, you know what I'm saying here.
Yeah, but I guess
it's a reflection of us, as Plato says.
The
Republic is the soul of man writ large.
Yeah. So Lincoln's able to reflect, you know, the 1860s America. What makes 1860s America worth Lincoln compared to today when we're looking at again the lineup?
Yeah.
That's
a great question, and I don't want to be too ahistorical here, right? What is it about, how does Lincoln emerge? Well, I mean, you know, fortuna always has something to do with it. You know, great statesmen, I think, are rare in human history. Let's think if we can think of them, you know, Pericles, Churchill. Even Churchill is, some criticize Churchill and don't want to include him because of his policies with the, I don't, sorry. You got me for that one. There's few statesmen, few seem to manifest this political race. But what is it then, what was it in terms of, if Plato's doctrine is true, and if you get the leader you deserve, what is it about the 19th century? Well, let me ask you guys, what do you think? Do you think there's a difference between the 19th century culture and us? Was the 19th century, you know, despite this bloodletting, more virtuous in some ways? Maybe more vicious in some ways in terms of racism, but were there the level of literacy, let's say, in the North, or the piety, you know? I know McPherson says that the soldiers of the Civil War were the most pious generation of Americans. Does that have something to do with it? Maybe Lincoln's biblical rhetoric, right? Using the cadences of the King James Bible. I think that's a good specific answer to your question. That Lincoln wove the Bible into his speeches and writings, right? The four score is a reference to 80 years, right? And it's mentioned in the Bible. The monosyllabic language, the cadences of the Gettysburg Address. Scriptural quotations, right? In the sweat of thy brow shall you eat bread. Genesis 3:19, Lincoln invokes against slavery. Okay, Lincoln is working with a Bible reading audience who took the authority presumed the authority of the Bible. And so that certainly is an important way in which the mid-Victorian 19th century America shaped his statesmanship. And that, a great statesman in terms of rhetoric has to know your audience. Now, does this say that Lincoln, there are some who make this argument that, Lincoln was an atheist and he manipulated the Bible as a political tool for his audience. I don't buy that argument, although I do think he was heterodox, unorthodox. So that would be a specific example. An example today is, Lincoln was invoking the Bible. Our candidates are using tweet and Twitter and all kinds of social media. Right? I mean, I remember my students, I just got an invitation to go to the rally. I'm like, oh. Yes?
My name is Joey. Thank you for coming.
That's my name. Joey? Yeah. You from New York?
No, Ohio. So my question is, well, you mentioned Abraham Lincoln and Frederick Douglass. So one more Douglass question. You know what it is. Do you see that there, can you think of any tie or correlation between the thought of Douglass and on Abraham Lincoln's second inaugural address? Specifically, I'm thinking of his understanding of the role of divine intervention in bringing about the Civil War.
I think there are a lot of parallels there. And I think that would be a worthy scholarly endeavor, because one sees that one sees how this biblical rhetoric, and by rhetoric I don't mean BS. I mean the language, the topos, how that, and the ethos, the moral appeal, influenced Douglass's thinking. And again, a lot of this was the part of the age, but Douglass. Douglass took this seriously, and it's interwoven like Lincoln. This question of divine judgment and redemption and atonement for the slave, it's there. It's in Douglass's writings. And one can, I don't know, you may be able to, make an argument that, to what extent did, Lincoln in his few conversations with Douglass, may he have been influenced. That's going to be hard to trace a direct find a smoking gun. We can definitely say that this is this is a certain form of biblical rhetoric that is present in Douglass's writings in parallel to Lincoln, and it says something about the American mind and perhaps the power of these symbols, the power of these symbols in the service of a righteous cause. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, I guess I've actually written on that, so that's why I asked.
I think it's a great topic. We can talk maybe later on.
Yeah.
What are some of the speeches of Douglass's that you're looking at? We don't have to do it now, but
yeah.
I'd be interested in what are you specifically focusing on, and what are some of the tropes you're looking at? It'd be great. Sir, yes. From Mississippi?
No, Wyoming.
Close.
my name's Ivan. I wanted to fire back a little on the idea that it's
sure.
the times in general that allowed the people to choose Lincoln, because he succeeded James Buchanan, Zachary Taylor, Millard Fillmore, not exactly men who inspired that same sense of greatness.
That's a great point.
We were actually talking about this in
Succession of Zeros, right? I mean, yeah.
Right. We were talking about
Comedy of Errors.
Churchill class, where the same thing happened, where you had Baldwin and Chamberlain,
yeah.
But then the war hits, you have Churchill.
Yeah.
And so, do you think that if we had some sort of great crisis, we might be able to find a great figure today?
That's a great question. I must sound like a broken record. Obviously, I'm enjoying this. What you just touched on, I think, is very important. And it's a question. I don't know I think human beings may never know, but great statesmanship seems to manifest itself. Aristotle does say this in terms of great crises. And so perhaps, not simply the times, and I wouldn't say it's simply the times. I want to say we can say the times influence. But there's always fortuna, but perhaps some great calamity that provides an opportunity for this greatness to more fully manifest itself. Like the Great Depression, right? And FDR, I think you guys don't like that. FDR, right? I mean, we'll give them some credit, okay? Or Britain during the outbreak of World War II, or America during the Civil War. But still, why Lincoln and not Buchanan? I think we'll never know. But again, the point of your question, I think that we all should keep in mind is does greatness most fully manifest itself in terms of some great crisis? Right? Who was lamenting the fact that there was no, that there's a great story, that there was no war? Well, Teddy Roosevelt. that's a great example. Teddy Roosevelt laments the fact, just to kind of to prove your point, there's no great war here while I'm president. So his capacity for achieving greatness was limited, may have been bound. Interesting. Yes.
Thank you for coming. Going back to the topic of Ex-parte Milligan, can you
Milligan or Merriman? Milligan was an 1866.
Yeah.
They're the court rebuked Lincoln.
Yeah.
And it was Chase couldn't wait to do it. His former secretary of the Treasury. Yeah.
Yeah. Going back to Ex parte Milligan, can you explain Lincoln's constitutional thinking in setting up military tribunals in Indiana where there was no rebellion?
Yes. Yeah. I mean that's one of the most, I think, controversial actions that Lincoln took during the war were the establishment of military tribunals, and the estimates vary. There were some think 36,000 Americans may have been tried by these military tribunals. I don't want to defend the indefensible. There was Copperhead resistance in Indiana. Now, also too, that the situation in Indiana was at the end of the war when Lincoln had been assassinated, in the case of Milligan, and there was chaos due to the end of the war and the Reconstruction policy. So Lincoln was dead by the time that case actually reached the court. But he did, the military tribunals were used throughout the North as well. So, the military tribunals kind of went along with the suspension of the writ of habeas corpus, okay? If the writ of habeas corpus is suspended, okay, then how do you provide due process, for those who are detained? And the civil courts may not have been functioning in all cases. In some cases, they were. So, Congress, of course, had a role in this too. This wasn't just Lincoln. This was Congress. I don't know if that's punting the ball. Yeah, it's problematic. It was probably, to my mind, one of the most problematic policies, but we never faced, I think, a crisis like that. And there was, historians will differ. Jennifer Weber wrote a book called Copperheads, where she sees the Copperhead threat, the insurgent threat, is very serious. And worst in Indiana, by the way, it was the worst there. And that there were conspiracies and schemes to, to free Confederates who were held in prison there, and to terrorize. So, but that's a, that's, I think, one of the most problematic aspects of the Lincoln administration, the suspension, the use of military tribunals.
Professor Fornieri, do you have it in you to only take one more question?
Yes.
because I know you can go another 3 hours.
No, I'm sorry. Am I?
No. That was a bad attempt at humor.
Yeah. Oh.
No, my attempt was bad. I know you love this. You can keep going, and we could. But can we take one more question?
Only if I get some tea.
I'm not kidding. I'm a teaser.
Please, yeah.
Thank you. My name is Kelly.
So
we're able today to determine who's a philosopher statesman like Lincoln or Jefferson by looking at the entirety of their life's work. How do we or can we determine who's a statesman or who is statesman-like in the present in the moment? And do we have to rely on future generations to sort of figure that out, because we have to wait until their either public life is over or they've passed away?
I can't completely answer that question with any full satisfaction. We have to make a choice, right? We have to go to the polls. I just feel a little dehydrated, you know. So we have to make a choice. So we need. My point is, as citizens, it's good to have this framework in mind. Who really lives up to Lincoln's standard, right? Is it such a high standard it's irrelevant? I don't think so, right? We can distinguish between leaders who employ sophistries, or leaders who are demagogic, or leaders who serve certain sections or factions of the country, as opposed to the country as a whole. We could probe leaders' characters. Right? How reliable is their character? How are their intellects being used? What is the vision? I think we have to ask, what is the vision of each of these potential candidates? What is a lot of talk about Bernie Sanders, and now he's engaging in a debate with a lot of the CEOs. Those are two rival visions, right? Of America's economy. Which rival vision will we choose? Ultimately, I think when we look at judgment, to your second question, I think we do need some historical distance. I think we need some historical distance because there's, just like we could better appreciate Lincoln's principled stance on emancipation when sources come out that in fact he had issued it 2 weeks before the letter to Greeley. That helps us appreciate and contextualize more his principled statesmanship. Where if we didn't have that information, we might think that this was simply a pragmatic act. See what I'm saying? Things will be revealed over time that will give us a fuller appreciation. I guess things can be more distorted, right? If you live in a Stalinistic state where history gets wiped out, things can be distorted, and that's the danger of totalitarian societies. They want to distort the facts and cover up the truth. So, thank you so much, everybody. I really appreciate it.
So, don't forget next Tuesday the luncheon at 12 with Jason Riley. Okay, so I think that's our last, other than the dinner, that's our last Ashbrook event of the year. So look forward to seeing you all there. Have a great weekend.
Thanks, guys.